Today on Gardening with Creekside, I finally get some annuals in the ground here at the patio space. Stay tuned to see how I do it. Hello friends, welcome to Gardening with Creekside. I am Jenny and here we are at the beds surrounding our new patio space. And I have got some more plants in the ground, super excited about this. Of course, you know, full disclosure here at Gardening with Creekside, I filmed this video yesterday by myself. The boys were getting their haircuts and running errands. The girls were off doing their thing. So I was gonna go ahead and plant these annuals and I started working on it and then I was like, why am I not filming this? I knew that y'all would enjoy the process and that you would want to see what I was doing. So I went in and grabbed some cameras and began filming. Well, filming by yourself can be quite interesting, especially when it's hot, you're tired, and you're very sweaty. You kind of overlook some things. So I was checking the video last night and there was zero sound, like none. So it was like a silent movie. I was just sitting here talking and moving my hands and you could hear nothing. So we have great footage of the whole process, but no sound and no explanation. So that is what we are going to do this morning. I'm gonna kind of walk you through and tell you what I did while showing you the silent footage from yesterday. Okay, so here we are at the patio space. These are the big beds surrounding the whole area that we've talked about for a long time that we were going to plant. You saw us plant the tea olives behind us, all the bones of this space. We have the tea olives, and then we're going to put some azaleas in front of them, but we don't have the variety that we want yet, so we're saving that space. Eventually, probably next spring, I'm going to add some more David Austin roses to where you see these annuals and fill in with some various perennials. But for this year, I needed something to fill in the space, give us some color, give us some interest. And that is where annuals come in. That's the perfect place to use annuals as a placeholder, but giving you lots of color and interest for that season. So what I did, what I decided to use was some of the guara. They were in gallons, so I did five of those. Now the guara will actually be a perennial for us. If I don't want these guar in this exact space next spring, all I have to do is just dig them up and move them around this space. But I like it because, of course, it's still that nice, pretty, pale pink. They're tall, they're very wispy, so as the wind blows, they move. The bumblebees and the honeybees are already all over the plants, so they're great for attracting pollinators to your garden. Just brings a different kind of whimsy and texture to the space. Again, full disclosure. So evidently yesterday when I was digging these, because I was using the power planter auger that we have. It's a fantastic tool. We've got the whole set, so it comes with the drill and different auger pieces, auger sizes. And so I was using it, and this ground here, y'all, is absolutely horrid. Horrid, horrid. Because, again, we've talked about this area gets full hot sun. It is nothing but red clay. This area has really not been amended as far as like over the years because it was just grass. So it's not really like rich in compost and so forth. So it is just basically concrete. So I was using that auger and just having to use all my weight pushing down on it to get any kind of hole. Again, it was better than using a shovel. So last night, Jerry had the irrigation hooked up for the first time and had it running. And unbeknownst to us, this morning we found out that I hit the main water line that goes from the control panel all the way up to the vegetable gardens and that area. So all night long, it was like this brook just bubbling up, and it was right underneath that guara. So again, didn't know about it. I hit it. I broke it. It ran all night long. So So that guara's got plenty of water. It's going to be fantastic. So unfortunately, I've got a project for Jerry to work on today to repair that line. Heck, maybe we'll show it to you in another video. But just to let you know, we all make mistakes and we all hit certain lines, and I had no idea. Like, I never even realized it. And it was the first plant that I actually dug. So I went through and did the guara first, and then in front of the guara, I used the angelonas, the angel face super white. Again, these will be annuals, but the super white is fantastic because they're nice and big. So of course you have the angel face white. This is super white, bigger. It's fantastic for landscapes or large containers. Basically, it is the angel face white on steroids. It just gets a lot larger, taller, fuller, bigger, fatter blooms. So those will fill in. Again, it gives me a different texture. The guar is light and airy and flows. The super white angel face is nice and tall and erect and just gives me a whole different structure to it. And then in front of those, I filled it in with the Supertunia Vista Silverberry. Again, nice, soft, white, pink colors to it. They will fill in this whole area like a carpet. Now, I've always told you, of course, with the perennials, shrubs, and trees, we always use biotone. I normally don't use biotone on my annuals. Well, this time I did. I did use biotone on all of these plants because two reasons. One, the ground is so terrible. I mean, it's just awful. So especially if these silverberries in the front along the pathway, if they do great, then that is just a testimony to how, you know, strong and vigorous these plants are, because it was just horrible soil. So everything got biotone because the soil quality is just bad. And then two, because of the time of year that I'm planting. Yesterday was so hot. Today we're overcast, it's cloudy, it's nice and cool. Yesterday I was dying. It was just hot. The dew point was out the roof, and it was not a very pleasant experience, but it got done and they look great. The guara did receive plant tone, so it got a nice healthy dose of plant tone around it. I might need to go back and add a little bit more to the first guara because it's probably all washed away. And then the angelonas and the petunias did get proven winners, the time release fertilizer. So that's great, because if I'm not out here all the time, you know, if I miss fertilizing, it's okay with the liquid. The time release is released by temperature. So when it's hot, it releases. So you don't have to, you can use them in conjunction with each other. You can use the time release and you can use the water soluble together. It's okay, you're not over fertilizing. I will come back and I will fertilize the angelonas and the silverberries with that water soluble fertilizer really about once a week. Again, this soil is horrible. They're not going to get a ton of nutrition from the ground, so I need to make sure that I am giving them the food that they need. And then, of course, everything is nice and tucked in with some great mulch. That nice thick layer of mulch really does help, one, with weed prevention, and then two, it helps to retain any water moisture that is in there in the ground, so it helps them go through this very hot season that we are about to enter into. So I got those done, and then I moved on over to the other section closer to the patio. So let's go over there and talk about that. Okay, so here we are, just right off of the patio. When we planted this space, I knew that I wanted to leave a little pocket right here, right by the pathway, for some good pops of color. Because we have the nine bark in the center, that is an amber jubilee nine bark there, and then it is flanked with the two August Chuck Hayes gardenias, which will be, they are wider than they are tall. So this space will really fill in, and we have this framed area with this kind of hole in the middle. So I was thinking that this would be a great place to put annuals. Again, I could change it out every year. It would be lots of fun, different colors, so forth and so on. This is why I like to kind of sit on a space for a little bit before I actually plant it, because that night I had a great inspiration and I was like, I have these brand new Amazing Daisy trial plants from Walter's Gardens that they sent us. This is marshmallow. So marshmallow will be introduced next year. It is a nice, big, fat, double bloom, really full, hence the name marshmallow, creamy white, a yellow center. They will be continuous bloomers all season long, especially if I keep up with them and I'm deadheading them, which I plan on doing since it's really close right here and I can just, when one gets old, I can just snip it and they can continue to bloom. So Walters sends us 5 plants when they send us trial plants, which is amazing because then you can really use them in the landscape as opposed to just having one. So I've got 5 of them and I planted them basically kind of in a diamond shape with one in the center. The spacing on these guys is about 20 inches apart. The look that I'm going for is that as they grow and as they develop, it will eventually look like one huge mass of the same flower. Laura had done a picture on her social media last year using Daisy May and had done that, and it was just spectacular. It was this glorious display. It looked like this one huge massive plant, but it wasn't. It was multiple plants that were planted close to each other. So that's the look that we're going for, so that we will have this huge area of one solid massive plant. They're only going to get to be about 20 inches tall, so I don't have to worry about them being too tall and overtaking the gardenias or the nine bark. So those will stay. Those are perennials. Those will always be here, and each year they just get larger and fuller and better and more glorious. I do have some space in front of them that I can use annuals. So again, I have these beautiful trial caladiums that Classic Caladiums sent us that I wanted to, I was like, this is the perfect space to use and try caladiums, one in the landscape and two in the full hot sun, because right now I don't have caladiums in this kind of location. I have them in the ground, but not in the full hot sun. So this is gonna be a little test to see how they do. Even though the Classic sent us these caladiums and they are, quote, trial plants for us, both of these are proven winner caladiums. So of course, right here in the front, I have 3 of the White Wonder, which is the caladium of the year. White Wonder is fantastic because it has those nice white creamy centers, the green edging, and these have actually a lot of pink veining in them. So it works really well for us because that's kind of the colors that we're using this year. So I have 3 of them that were planted here. These were in gallon size containers, and so they will just of course get larger and more glorious as the summer progresses. And then on each side I have flanking them, this is Blushing Bride. It is another proven winner's caladium. Again, it has more of a heavily, it's kind of like the reverse of the White Wonder, where it has a lot of the pink center green edging with a little bit of flecks of white in it. So those will fill in. Caladiums, if you are not familiar with caladiums, if you don't use caladiums in your yard, I really encourage you to, especially if you are in the South and you have, or not even in the South, but you have hot, humid weather during the summer, especially at night. Caladiums just thrive in the heat and the humidity. One of the things that makes gardening in the South challenging is that our nights do not cool down, especially in the summer. I mean, we can have 80 degree nights and the humidity, the dew point is just out the roof. Caladiums thrive in that kind of environment. A lot of plants suffer, not caladiums. They absolutely thrive in that environment. So caladiums are a great example where you have no flower, but you have massive color and interest and presence. You don't have to have flowers to make your garden interesting and fun and unique. So these will just get nice and full. I know that they're planted, especially these kind of 3 right here, are planted close to the edge of the pathway. That's great. I kind of planned it that way. I want them to get nice and full, and if they spill over kind of here at the edge, then that's great because it'll soften the edge of the hard metal edging, and so that's wonderful. Right now, again, this will all be on drip irrigation, so they'll just get water on a regular basis. That's really important, especially in an environment like this where they get sun up to sundown. You've got to water them. Otherwise, they're probably just going to shrivel up and die because you've got to water your plants, people. So especially in hot, sunny conditions, you just got to make sure that they get the water. And when I planted these, again, I did go ahead and use Biotone on all of them, just again, because of the soil, because of the location they are, and the time of year that I'm planting them. So I wanted them to have a great start. And then I did go ahead and use Plant Tone on all 3 two different plants, three varieties of these plants. So both the daisies and the two different kinds of caladiums got plant tone around them to help them have a great start and lots of yummy food. I hope that you have found this interesting. Again, this was not the video that I actually intended to have, but you know what? Such is life. We just go with it. You go with, roll with the punches and you'll just see where it takes you. But already it has just made a massive difference to have this nice of pop of color in here. We're still going to be adding more perennials to this area. I've already got some more plans that I have in mind that I want to do. So again, this is a continuous project. As always, thank you so much for coming on the journey with us. Y'all have a fantastic day. We'll see you in the next video. Bye, friends. Thank you.